comes a time when we hit a certain call, when the world must come together as one. There are people dying.
Oh, when it's time to lend a hand to life,
the greatest gift of all.
We can't go on pretending day by day
that someone somehow will soon make a change.
We are all a part of God's great big family, and it's true, you know, love is all we need.
We are the children, we are the children, we are the ones who make a brighter day, so let's start giving.
There's a choice we're making, we're saving our own lives. It's true, we'll make a better day, just you and me.
Well, send them your heart, oh, so they know that someone cares.
So their cries for help will not be in vain.
We can't let them suffer. No, we cannot turn them.
Well, good afternoon, folks in Radio Lane, and a pleasant welcome to another edition of the program Inside JFK. Inside JFK is a 45-minute radio program brought to you by the management of the John Fitzgerald Kennedy Medical Center, a program that provides you, our listeners, the opportunity to interact with policymakers and medical doctors from the nation's premier medical center. That is the John Fitzgerald Kennedy Medical Center. So today is November 6, 2023, and today we have the Department of Pediatric from the JFK Medical Center, and we'll be discussing a very important topic today, and that is diabetes mellitus. You know, that's the scientific name for diabetes, but we all know it to be diabetes. We just say diabetes, you know, but it's diabetes mellitus. But when we introduce our guest, she's going to explain further relative to that. So today we have Dr. Hawa Koon. She's a pediatrician, let's say a pediatric indo. She would define that. Let's say she would pronounce that word in her introductory remarks, you know. But you can say she's a pediatrician because she take care of babies or kids, that we would say. And she's from the John F. Kennedy Medical Center also. So diabetes is a topic for today. And because of time, we will go straightly to her so that she can introduce herself properly. So good afternoon, Dr. Koon, and welcome to the program Inside JFK.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Hawa Soni Koon, as I was introduced. Okay. I'm a pediatric endocrinologist.
Okay.
Endocrinologist.
Okay.
I work at the JFK Medical Center, specifically the children department that is called pediatrics.
Great.
So it's good to be back in studio. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. So we are discussing diabetes mellitus. I don't know if that's the right pronunciation of the last one.
It's good.
Okay. So someone out there who is glued to their monitor or the radio, we want to know what is diabetes. You know, we usually talk about this medical condition in Liberia a lot. You know, everybody say you get diabetes. So please explain to the public what is diabetes.
Thank you. So for today's discussion is no big terms.
Okay.
We're going to come down to the level of everyone and be simple.
Okay.
To begin, before I can define what diabetes is all about, first we're going to be talking about blood sugar.
Okay.
We have sugar in the blood, and the disease that is associated with having so much sugar in the blood is what we call diabetes. Okay. The body has to keep the sugar in a range.
Mm.
It has to be at a specific range. Let's say 70 should be the lowest.
Okay.
And at a maximum range, let's say normal, it should be less than 110.
Mm.
So within that range, it's considered normal sugar. So that's how the body wants to be to perform well.
Okay.
So if it goes above and above the normal range, then the blood is kind of sweet.
Okay.
So if you have a sweet blood, then you have diabetes mellitus. That's the simplest way to define it.
Okay. So when you have a sweet blood, then with me you have diabetes.
Yes,
because
you have sugar
sickness. In terms of breaking this down in the simplest way possible for our the audience, right?
Yes.
For people who are listening. I think some people say you eat too much sugar, that's why you get diabetes. Is that a fact?
So
you eat too much sugar?
So diabetes is in the endocrine, it falls on the endocrine system. And the endocrine talks about hormones of the body.
Hormones.
So there's a hormone that is mainly responsible for diabetes that is called insulin.
Okay. Insulin.
So
what is that?
This insulin is on is the name of a hormone.
Okay.
If you do not have insulin, you will have diabetes. If you have insulin and insulin is not noticed, like the body does not sense that insulin is around, you will have diabetes. That drives into the types of diabetes we have. So the diabetes that has to do with insulin not being around is what we find mostly amongst children. And we call that one type 1 diabetes. So insulin is not around. The body is not producing insulin.
Okay.
And in the older people, let's say sometimes now we are seeing it in young adults and even in children. When the sugar, the insulin is around, but the insulin is not noticed. It means that the body does not sense the presence of insulin.
Okay.
Then you develop diabetes. Because insulin is responsible to take the sugar you eat from your food into the cells to be utilized. If there's no insulin there, or you cannot recognize insulin, it means there's no way you're going to use your blood sugar. So if you eat whatsoever food and you have your insulin working well and is noticed very well, you don't have problem with the sugar accumulating in your blood to give you sugar sickness. But if you do not have insulin, or you have insulin, it's not enough, or you have insulin and it is not recognized by the cells to be able to make you use your blood sugar, then you the sugar will accumulate and then you have diabetes.
Okay. I think that is great. In terms of the explanation. I think people who are listening to the radio, I think they get an understanding of what diabetes is. So folks, if you are just joining us, this is a reminder that you are in tune to the program Inside JFK on ELPC. This program comes away every Monday from 1 o'clock to 1:45 p.m. And today we have Dr. Hawa Koon. She's a pediatrician, a pediatric endocrinologist from the JFK Medical Center. And she is discussing diabetes today, a very important topic. So that back to you. So what are the types of diabetes?
Okay.
I think they have several types.
Yes. Yes. So that's what I was mentioning, that there are other types.
Okay.
But the two commonest is the type 1 that we most often see in children.
Okay.
And the type 2 that we see mostly in adults. But you can also see it in young adults or in children. So those are the two most common types. There are other rarer types that is not common. So for this discussion, we wouldn't bring that in. We stick to what is common.
Okay. So the two that you just mentioned are the commonest.
Yes, the type 1 where there is no insulin, and the type 2, insulin is there, insulin is low, but the main problem, it is not noticed, it is not recognized. So because it's not recognized, you can benefit from its presence in the body.
Okay. All right. So so what age group is likely to be affected by this disease? What age group is at risk of getting diabetes? Is there a specific age group?
There is no specific. Because for children, type 1 is common.
Okay.
For adults, type 2 is common. And even you can have newborns, babies that are just born. They can also have another kind, but that's not within the common ones we are talking about. Okay. They can also have another type of diabetes. So no age is exempted. Anyone can have diabetes.
Anyone?
Just anyone.
Okay. So because I was doing the research on the topic, and then I saw something at the 45 or so above, something like that. I don't know if we're talking about the types, which I don't know if that's the type they were talking about. They say 45 up, you know. Yeah.
So once you're talking about 45 up, we know we are in adult, and I'm a pediatrician.
Yeah, you're a pediatrician.
But 45 up, it ties into one. It's just what the prevalence, what has been seen, and what has been observed.
Okay.
But there are risk factors that causes one to easily develop diabetes. That we can talk about as we go.
Okay. Sure. Okay. So how common is diabetes, especially in Liberia, based on your own clinical research? You're a doctor. You see patients, even though you are specifically, let's say you have your own area of studies, also maybe treating children and all of that, but you have done your own clinical, from your own clinical assessment. How common is diabetes in Liberia?
So diabetes is common. It's like, as we refer to high blood pressure, sometimes it's referred to like a silent killer, especially amongst adults.
Okay.
Because it stays a long time, and by the time you diagnose an adult with diabetes, they are almost having complications of diabetes. Unlike children, by the time they go 1 or 2, 3 weeks with diabetes, the type 1, it shows. It doesn't hide like the adults.
Yeah.
So when you come to a risk factor for diabetes, they weight, adding weight. Those that are, because the more you have increase in your weight,
yeah,
the more your body does not sense the presence of diabetes. So they overweight and obesity are significant risk factor for type 2 diabetes. For type 1 diabetes, that's most often seen in children, you don't have no specific risk factor. It comes on anybody at any time, any child at any time. Because for that one, it's the body. A medical personnel refer to it as autoimmune, meaning your own body destroys the organ that's supposed to provide the insulin. So it damages the specific cells that should give you insulin.
Okay.
So because it kills those cells, you don't see the insulin anymore. So that's in type 1.
Okay.
But type 2 insulin is there, but the overweight, or sometimes we see people buy medicine like steroids, like sometimes they take medicine to get fat. Some of those steroids, when their bones hurting and everything, they take steroids. Anytime they go to overhead counter, they give you steroids. It's a group of drugs. They have like prednisolone and all those things. Sometimes they have the steroid cream. And even by creaming with it, it enters your body and also place you at risk of diabetes.
Wow.
So for the adults, it's more the steroid or the drug induced, or let's say overweight, which is the highest cause, or obesity, predisposing or causing an adult to have diabetes. But for children, there's no specific way you can prevent diabetes in a child.
Okay. All right. So before we come to the symptoms, what are those things you're going to be observing in order for you to maybe say, okay, I need to see the doctor? Apparently, from what the education I was given on the radio, I'm experiencing these signs and symptoms and all of that. I need to get to the hospital. Maybe I have diabetes or so. But we want to ask you this this question relative to the signs and symptoms.
Okay.
Because people are, like, sometimes you see in your community, people's legs are swollen, you know, like, and then every time you ask about someone's legs is swollen, and then they will usually say the person has, you know, diabetes. So sometimes I ask, have you gone to the hospital to do a checkup to know as to whether this leg that is swollen, you know, and is related to diabetes? So what are those signs and symptoms actually that you
observe? When the sugar gets much in the blood, when it passes a specific number, the kidneys cannot stop it from coming out anymore.
Okay.
So it spills into the urine. It spills into the kidneys. Once it spills into the kidney above a certain level, you know, almost like the way the salt can draw the water from the worm. Once it spills into the kidney, it draws water into your kidneys and causes you to urinate a lot. So you find out that this person starts to urinate more often or frequent compared to what they used to do before. And an easy way to notice it is bedtime or you sleeping before you sleep. You used to sleep all night. You don't get up.
Yeah.
But you notice that you're sleeping now. You're waking up to urinate. Mm. So all those frequency, you have to know that something is causing you, because once sugar passes a certain level, it's going to cause you to urinate more.
Okay.
And once you urinate more, you find that you will end up drinking a lot. So that's why the common presentation is someone who drinks a lot and is urinating a lot. So those people, that's a way that you can pick up that, oh, something is happening, I need to see your doctor. Okay. It most likely might be diabetes, to see your doctor. For for adults, they are on the big side. So they are like overweight or obese. For the children, you will notice that they will start losing weight. They start getting, the parents can't understand, the child looks drained. The child is reducing and everything. So it's on the extreme. The adult is on the big side. The child is losing weight. But both of them will be urinating. Like, you have your child and your child is bedwetting. The child, maybe the child start bedwetting before 3-4, the child wasn't urinating. Then the child 10 years old starts urinating again. So those things, those recurrence of bedwetting from a child who stopped bedwetting, those should prompt concern for the parents. And that's the OUP people. You got to find out, why is this child now bedwetting? Because it's the sugar, once the sugar gets a lot in the kidneys, you cannot control it. And you're going to pass urine, even unconsciously.
Wow.
Yes.
Okay. So, folks in Better Land, again, if you are just tuning in, this is a reminder that you are in tune to the program Inside JFK on ELBC. Inside JFK is a 45-minute radio program brought to you by the management of the John Fitzgerald Kennedy Medical Center, a program that provides you, our listeners, the opportunity to interact with our doctors and specialists at the JFK Medical Center, where you get educated, medical advice on issues that health-related issues that are affecting you in your community. So today we are discussing diabetes, and we have Dr. Hawa Koon here from the JFK Medical Center, and she is discussing the topic today. So we will open the line subsequently, but in subsequent time, we're going to open the line so that you can call in to ask her the necessary questions relating to the topic on our discussion. But before then, we would like to ask you, Dr. Koon, about the causes. I guess from the initial, that's a statement also in the definition, you talk about that a bit, but did not go in details. So what causes diabetes? What are the main causes of diabetes?
Yes, so it will just be repeating what I said, maybe just to emphasize or reinforce.
Okay, yeah, reinforce.
Yes, for children, as I said, there's no specific cause that you can explain outside the scientific cause.
Okay.
Where the body destroys what should produce the insulin.
Okay.
So that's the cause of type 1 diabetes. The body produces antibodies that destroys the specific cell that should produce insulin.
Okay.
But for an adult or for type 2 diabetes, insulin is around, but the cells don't notice it.
Okay.
And what could cause the cell not to notice it? As we said, the number one risk factor is overweight or obesity. It's a risk factor that will cause you to have diabetes. So if you want to stay away from diabetes, you have to make sure you maintain a good weight.
Okay.
Because weight will make you not to notice it. And I said another secondary could be drug induced. We can easily over the counter buy prednisolone, buy all kinds of
medication.
Those medications, some of them, especially the steroids, that's the group of medication. So you buy something, Google and see if it has steroid in it. It is a risk factor for diabetes. You don't want to take it.
Okay. Wow. Okay. So I think we can announce the numbers while we conclude. So you can call us on 0777-7035-30 if you want to be a part of the program to ask Dr. Koon on what she's explaining here today on diabetes. You can call us on those on that number, 0777-7035-30. As we go further, we pick your calls so that you can make your input on the program and ask her those relevant questions. So, Dr. Koon, so what are some of the complications of diabetes? If you have diabetes, what are some of those or maybe other sicknesses that is likely to be or that you will encounter?
Okay, diabetes, as I said, we should broaden our minds to the two types. We gotta have type 1.
Yeah.
And the complication of type 1 is a little, there's a complication that is more common in type 1 than what you see in type 2. So, there's an acute complication. Acute means what kills very fast. It just snap comes on and then it's able to kill the child.
Okay.
So we refer to it in abbreviation as DKA. And it causes the child to vomit.
Okay.
The child urinates almost all the water and gets dehydrated. The child is vomiting and everything. So everything is not malaria.
Okay.
So a child that is vomiting, looking drained, it doesn't mean. And sometimes the stomach starts to hurt so much, it doesn't mean it's malaria. It could just be some of the complication of diabetes. But for the general public, the complication is divided into two. You have the ones that affect the big vessels and the ones that affect the small vessels. The ones that affect the small vessels is what is killing a lot of diabetic patients nowadays. We find out that the small vessels that are in the kidneys, they get damaged. And because of that, diabetics can have nephropathy or kidney disease.
Okay.
And because of that, their kidneys will fail and they die from there. Diabetes can also affect the eye. Somebody could develop cataract.
Yeah, diabetes. Yeah, we are discussed with the...
Yes, they can develop cataract. Yes, and when they develop cataract, it can also cause blindness. But at least that one is a repairable one. You can be able to see again.
Okay.
But it can damage the vessels.
Okay.
And once it damages the vessels, the doctors will call it retinopathy.
Yeah,
once it goes far like that, you are is to save the sight. It's kind of like difficult to fix the sight.
Okay.
Then also the nerves. Diabetes can cause you your feet can be numb. You can't even feel when someone is pinching you. Sometimes it feels like they are pricking needles on your feet. So you lose sensation. And because of that, that's one reason why you find out that diabetics can easily have sores on their feet. Because
if they
are not feeling. So because you are not feeling when something hurts you, you don't know. Then the big vessels, there's damage to the big vessels that should carry blood around. So because of that, they are not able to carry good.
Lines are boozing back, so just take off your cord. But you can continue while we take these cord. It's just so
funny. They are unable
to have this line.
They are unable to carry good blood around. So because of that, you find out that diabetics also or the sores on their feet will not heal. You need good blood to go to anywhere that there's a wound. But because the diabetes can cause your blood not to flow well, it makes your blood vessels very tiny. So blood cannot flow well. So because of that, if there's a sore or there's a wound on your leg and blood is not there very well,
it takes long to heal. Yeah, let's take the call. Good afternoon, caller. Anymore, you calling from? Welcome to the program, Inside JFK.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Julius. Actually, I'm calling from Louisiana Township.
Okay, welcome, Julius.
Okay, thank you. Let me say thanks to the Darren CEO for educating us. Especially when it comes with diabetes, when it comes to generic, especially where it is a family inherent. How well, can they communicate? You know, to communicate to people to know which type of diet, which type of drink to take in, because at times, sometimes it can be,
So your concern is about the genetic nature of the diabetes. Okay, she will address that. Good afternoon, caller. Anymore you calling from? I think that caller dropped the line. Let me take this one. Good afternoon, caller. Anymore you calling from? Welcome to the program, Inside JFK.
Good afternoon. Well, I can say thank you to the guy for this video.
Okay.
I want to ask my question. I have a problem that is very embarrassing. I have a sore in my mouth. My whole lip is so sore. Somehow it's very my gum. All around my teeth. You can hear that bump, 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 and there's no whistle for me to even brush my mouth. And second time, it's time my feet with me, swelling, and then I already know the pattern of it.
Okay, okay. So can I keep following the program?
I've been drinking before.
Okay, okay, so keep following, okay? That will address your concern. Just keep following the show. That will address your concern, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you for calling. Yeah. Good afternoon, caller anymore. You calling from? Welcome to the program Inside JFK.
Hello.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, I am calling. I'm sitting back now on my radio. I'm myself calling for last week, sitting here for now. I get stroke.
Okay, so I didn't know that you went to the hospital and you were diagnosed of it?
Yeah, I was.
Oh, we lost her. Wow. Okay, you can call back if you are still monitoring the program. You can call back. We will pick you. The lines are buzzing, Doc. So I think we have to
keep it on the phone.
Good afternoon. And welcome to the program Inside JFK.
Yeah, my name is Michelle Cooper, and I'm two journalists from the first place.
Okay.
I want to ask a question.
Mm-hmm.
The student there talks about autoimmunity.
Okay.
And I want to ask a question. What is autoimmunity, and how can autoimmunity be the start of autoimmunity?
What is autoimmunity?
Yeah,
she got that.
Autoimmunity.
Okay, she got that. She will explain that to you.
Another question is, if I'm starting to be doing a big work and then I begin to drink every 5 minutes, so how will you consider that?
Frequent drinking of water, right? Okay.
Yeah, while doing a big work.
Okay, all right. Thank you. Yeah, so I think you can address those concerns first. That you conclude with what you were saying first on the issue that has to do with, I think, was it the complications, right?
Yes. So the complications, I think it answers one or two
can
of the questions.
Take this one first before you go into. Yeah, good afternoon, caller. Anymore, you calling?
Yeah, welcome
to the program Inside JFK.
Yeah. The woman talk about that sometimes the weight can cause the diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. What the person can take to reduce the weight? Because especially me, I don't like to have weight, and my foot, my leg hurting.
Mm-hmm.
I can take the penicillin and it can make more fat.
Okay.
So I want to help me to prescribe something that will reduce me. I don't want to be fat.
Okay. All right. Thank you. So keep following. She jotting down all of your points and she will respond to you. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you for calling. Back.
All right.
Okay. That we can just. I think we have much of the callers now. So you can just go into.
Okay. So let me just conclude on the complications. So the complication of diabetes can affect the big vessels and the small vessels in the body.
Okay.
The vessels are what takes blood around.
Mm-hmm.
So the ones that it affects the big vessels, it causes the big vessels to get small.
Okay.
And it causes the vessels not to stretch. You know, our blood vessels almost acts like it has some elastic.
Mm.
It can move, it can stretch.
Okay.
So when you have sugar sickness for long, it makes it stiff.
Mm.
It can stretch and it makes it small. Blood cannot pass.
Okay.
So if blood cannot pass through it, one thing that can happen, it can burst.
Okay.
And if it bursts in your brain, it will cause you stroke.
Okay.
Hmm? Mm. Then also,
I
if the blood...
To the lady who said,
as we go through the complications, yes. Once the blood cannot pass and the blood vessel is so stiff because of the excess sugar for a long time, the vessels can burst.
Mm.
And because of that, wheresoever the vessel bursts, where the blood wastes after the vessel bursts, it damages that place.
Okay.
And when it bursts in your brain, it damages the part of your brain where the vessel bursts.
Okay.
Also, if the vessel is supposed to carry blood somewhere, and the vessel is so small that it cannot carry the blood there, it means that you are not going to be receiving blood in that part of your body. Example, you see diabetics, their legs. Most of the time, they don't have good blood reaching to their legs because all the vessels are getting so small, it's so stiff, it can't stretch good, blood cannot pass.
Is that what caused the swelling?
The swelling, yes. Once the swelling is caused by, because you cannot feel, so you scrape your leg, but there's no blood going there sufficiently, that swelling cannot heal. So that's the reason why you can find out that you have to cut the leg of a diabetic, because if you don't cut it, it will never heal because the blood supply is so poor.
Okay.
So you have to cut the leg where there's good blood supply. So doctors can advise them to cut the leg. And that's something that you can prevent.
Okay.
You can prevent it from happening. So the thing about diabetes, as I said initially, I talked about autoimmunity. Autoimmunity is when your body is supposed to produce fighter against diseases.
Okay.
So if you have malaria, or you have, let's say, typhoid, or you have fresh cold, those common ones, your body should produce antibodies that will fight it.
Okay.
But there are conditions that the body produce antibodies to fight itself. So if your body produce antibodies to fight yourself, your own body, that's autoimmune conditions. So the diabetes amongst children, the body produces antibodies that fight the organs that produce the insulin. So it destroys it, then the person develops diabetes. So that's autoimmunity, for your body to produce fighters that will fight itself, then fighting these other diseases that come from outside. Then also we talk about the diet.
The kind of food you eat.
Yes, the kind of food you eat. For the children, we don't restrict them so much, because diabetes is a condition that affects more your carbohydrate based food. So carbohydrate based food is like your rice, your cassava, your fufu, your bread, your biscuit, your juice, your soft drink, all those food that have sugars are your carbohydrate based food. And if you don't have insulin, or insulin is not recognized, you cannot use those food. So if you have weight, and that's the major food that increases your weight, food that has sugar. So if you want to lose weight, or if you are type 2 diabetic, but for type 1, we don't restrict them too much. We just try and regulate their carbohydrate food, because they are growing. Because they are growing, they need all the nutrients. We cannot restrict them. Don't eat this, don't eat this. We can just manage them closely with the insulin education for them, and we pay keen attention to children. So for children, we have several classes with the parents to teach them. But for adults, the major thing is you have to lose weight. You have to reduce the calories, meaning reduce the food you're eating, the energy in the food. If you're eating one cup of rice, you got to eat 1/4 of it. You have to make sure you eat. It's good to eat natural things from the ground, than the real processed things.
Yeah, because that, especially for talking about the dieting, whatever the mother eats, definitely what the child may, if there's a breastfeeding a child, and definitely what the child is going to need to be sucking, right? So
for children,
yeah,
we do a plan for the entire family, because you cannot isolate a child to eat this and the other brothers, the sisters, they're eating something, your mom eating something else. That is so for children. We have a whole session. For a parent that has a child with diabetes, we kind of teach them how to modify the family diet. So that child does not feel, you know, so like depressed, because I have to do this, I have to do that. But for an adult, for an adolescent, for a young adult with diabetes, first thing, you have to lose your weight. You have to lose your weight by doing some exercises. You can even dance. Put radio in your ear and just dance. You are burning calories. Major, you have to cut down your sugar. No need for juices, soft drink, biscuit. Kato, you already own. And you need to reduce the weight. All those, the beating bread, all around it, just so much of those things that will increase your calories. So, and you have to reduce the portion size, like bringing less vegetables. But vegetables are excellent. That was what God created the world to be. Vegetables. So get your cucumber, your cabbage. You know, even if you slice your cucumber and put a little benesi on it, those are healthy things. Those are things that wouldn't make you to add weight. You lose weight. But you cannot say you want to lose weight and you starve yourself in the morning. No, anybody that is losing weight has to eat the regular diet.
You might also
you cannot starve yourself. It's just you have to reduce your calories. If you eat in the morning, say you're eating your cucumber and maybe small chicken or so, and reducing the carbohydrates, then you are eating something. But you can say, I will fast in the morning. No. Fasting makes the body goes into another state, and you will not lose weight. So you have to eat the 3 times a day, but you are eating food that has less calories. So your rest will be reduced. You will eat, if the chicken, you will eat the chicken more than the rest. you will make sure every time you cut your quicamon and your cabbage, you face more though, quitting and you put inside your rest. It's not expensive. You can find quicamon cheap and everything. Exactly. Those are things you will do.
To balance the diet also.
But I advise everyone in Liberia, no one should be taking prednisolone like that.
What is prednisolone?
Prednisolone is a steroid that I was talking about initially that causes diabetes. Okay. But most of the time, by the time the older people say my leg hurting, my back hurting, my everything, they will often give them prednisolone.
Oh, so they use prednisolone.
Is a magic drug. It solves almost every quick problem, but it's very dangerous.
Okay, that's a sign.
Yes, it has so much. It causes hypertension. It causes diabetes. It causes your bone to not be strong. It causes so many, many problems. So because of that, when you have to go to the hospital, even if the doctor has to put you on prednisolone, he'll put you on a short course for a short time. Not to just go to the drugstore and buy it, because it causes diabetes also.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
Let me see if I cover all the questions. Then one question asked about sewing the mouth. Diabetes is not a condition that will cause sore in the mouth.
Mm.
So if you start having sores in the mouth and everything, you need to try and go to the hospital so that they're able to find out what's happening to you. The earlier you find out what's happening to you, the better it is so that you're able to solve whatsoever problem.
I think we have another caller. Let's take, two or three more calls before we...
Yeah, there was a call about increased thirst.
Yeah, so let's just add this one to it. Good afternoon, caller. Anymore, are you calling from? Welcome to the program Inside JFK.
Hello.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Don't listen to the monitor. Listen to the phone. Please lower your monitor and listen to the phone.
How are you, bro?
Yeah.
Hello.
Please go ahead.
Yeah. I got calling from Boston. Yeah, I want to know something, but I just put the radio on and I just... And
we are discussing diabetes, so I think it's better that you follow the discussion, okay?
Yeah, but I already got sometimes.
Yeah, so then, for the sake of time, just go ahead. What's your concern?
Yeah, my concern is that, like, you are experiencing, you have diabetes, you PT,
fat,
and so I want to know what you are PT, fat, does it cause diabetes and fat? And you're not drinking at all, but you can keep it papa.
Okay.
You can't drink papa.
All right. Thank you. Check your following. She will respond to your concern, okay?
All right.
Thank you.
So, yes. So, diabetes, when you're urinating fast, you will have to be drinking fast.
Okay.
It goes hand in hand. Mm. So, if you're urinating fast and you're not drinking, you got to go to the hospital and find out. It could be pee-pee infection.
Yeah, sure.
Uh-huh. Mm. So, you want to go to the... But when you see yourself thirsty, and yet and still, you're still putting the water out, you're urinating, that points you more to go into the hospital to find out if you have diabetes.
Okay.
But anytime to mention... Someone asked question about drinking a lot when you are doing some physical work. Anytime you... The body has a mechanism to make you drink once it's getting dehydrated. So whatsoever thing that is causing you to get dehydrated, you will drink to replace the water. So you are drinking in diabetes because you are urinating your water and you get dehydrated and you drink.
Okay.
But if, let's say, you are working under the sun, you start to sweat, you start to lose a lot of water from your skin.
Okay.
You are getting dehydrated, and because of that, you also have to drink. So drinking is not equivalent to diabetes. You drink anytime you get dehydrated. You drink in diabetes because you are urinating a lot of your water that makes you dehydrated. That's the reason why you start to drink to replace that loss. So don't worry about exercising or doing a lot of work and drinking. It's normal. Once you are dehydrated, you have to drink.
So that was a concern for the last quarter.
Yes, please.
That you responded to. Okay, so for the sake of time, we will just take how you can diagnose this disease. How can you diagnose diabetes?
Okay, so diabetes is not diagnosed by the patient.
Okay,
it's diagnosed by the healthcare worker in the hospital, your doctor or your PA or whosoever you meet in the hospital.
Okay.
So, as I said, if you are drinking a lot and you are urinating a lot, or someone just started urinating in bed and all those things, when you go to the hospital, once you explain those things to your doctor would do tests.
Okay.
And the doctor does the test, there's a range that we expect the sugar to be. If the sugar goes above the range based on the test that the doctor orders, then the doctor will say that you have diabetes. So, diabetes is diagnosed by laboratory investigation when you visit the hospital.
Okay. So lastly, the treatment and management process.
So the treatment for management in children, mm-hmm. because as we said, in children, insulin is not there. So the treatment of children is replacing the insulin. Mm-hmm. So every child that has diabetes and the doctor says it's type 1 diabetes mm-hmm. or it's the children type of diabetes, the child has to take insulin via injection.
Okay.
Yes, so you have to take that insulin every time so that your sugar stays normal because you don't have insulin. So because you don't have insulin, the treatment is to replace the insulin. But for adults, the major problem is not there's no insulin. The major problem is you are not recognizing the insulin. So because you are not recognizing the insulin, for adults, we give you tablets so that you recognize the insulin. We give you tablets so that you don't take in all the sugar you put in your stomach so some of the sugar can go out in the feces. We give you tablets so that the body will not produce sugar as fast as the body will normally produce tablets. There are few patients that stay long with type 2 diabetes and because of that the insulin that they are producing gets smaller. It's not enough. So some of them, some adults, we end up putting in insulin injections to their tablets. But for type 2, it's mainly tablets that we use to treat it, and once a while we add insulin injections. While type 1 is all injections to replace the insulin. Insulin has no tablet.
Okay. So it's just all injections.
It's all injections.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hawa Koon, pediatric specialist at the JFK Medical Center. And this has been a very informative and educative discussion here today on diabetes. So that will take your final message to the public.
Okay.
So we'll take leave of you.
So this November 14 is World Diabetes Day.
Okay.
And they are focused on creating awareness so that we know that diabetes is here and it is common. The prevalence of diabetes from some studies that have been done in Liberia is between 2 to 3. So that number is significant. Also, I did a study among school children and the prevalence I identified was 2.1. It's also significant.
So that diabetes, was a research you carried?
That was a research that I just did among students from several schools. So diabetes is common. And because it's common, we need to embrace the fact and don't take it to be, some people take it to be medicine, this witchcraft, somebody want to wish me and everything. And that will cost their life because the more you delay, the outcome is bad. And it's good to do your routine. When you start to hit 40, 45, you go to hospital, let them just do your sugar test, make sure it's okay. Do your routine checkup because for type 2, you don't notice it until you are already having complications of diabetes. So it's good to always do your regular checkup. To the men, most of the time women like to go to hospital. But the men, they infrequently go to hospital. To the men in Liberia, do your best. Visit the hospital. Do your general checkup. Let them check your sugar. See if it's fine. And that's an addition to you. To parents who have children, if you find your child urinating or drinking a lot, please stop by at JFK. We love seeing anyone with any problem. We are serviceable. We are open to be of help. Come around and we'll serve you. We'll take care of you. Don't worry about place being packed. We'll prioritize you. So please come around. Always know that we are here, we are available, diabetes is real, and we can do our best to reduce the occurrences amongst adults. Make sure, keep your weight down, make sure exercise, and stay healthy. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. That was the voice of Dr. Hawa Koon from the pediatric department there at the JFK Medical Center. She's a pediatric endocrinologist, and she has been speaking on the topic of diabetes, and she has said, she talked about the treatment aspect, the symptoms associated with the disease and all of that. So for today's edition of the program Inside JFK, I've been your host, James Bill Creighton is my name, from the communications department at the JFK Medical Center. This is how we come to an end of today's edition of this program. And please do join us next Monday, the following Monday, not this Monday that is coming, the following Monday, you can join us, and then we can be able to discuss other important educative topics here. That is some of the diseases that are affecting you in your community. That's why we are here for at the nation's biggest referral hospital, John Fajero Kennedy Medical.